What is going on, guys? We got another episode for you guys today, and that is going to be another episode for the Forgotten series. And today we are going to be doing the first episode for 1994.
What's up, everybody? This is Jaren Galino from Lynch Mob and Heaven's Edge, and you're watching the Krash, Kourse Metal Show with my boy, Trevor Krash Knight. Crank it up.
So if you haven't watched our previous episodes of Forgotten Albums all throughout the 80s and then now here into the early 90s, go check out that series. Go check out the other episodes as well. But today, like I said, we are doing 1994. And I know what you're thinking. Crash, there isn't no good rock and roll, of the 80s style or, even like thrash metal, even like all the hair metal stuff. All that stuff's dead, right? No, I have plenty of choices for 1994, and we will do more episodes for 1994 as well. But for right now, I have three for you. And so let's just jump right into it here and go with our first choice. I knew the first one from 1994. I knew which one I was going to choose. And that is going to be none other than Goddard's Die Hard. All right, so this is Goddard's second album, coming after the 1992 self-titled, and here we are with Die Hard. Now, this one here, this will make probably the top 15 album of all hair metal for me. I just absolutely love it. Ever since I first heard this album, I was like, this album is so great. This album has a guitar tone to it, has great riffs, guitar riffs to it. Steve Lee, rest in peace, he has passed away now, but I think is one of the most underrated songwriters of this subgenre of like hair metal, sleaze metal, and such like that. But because, like, I always say, because recently I did an episode with Hair Metal Guru of bands that. Or albums, hair metal albums that survived grunge, and Die Hard was one of them here that I chose. And I said in that video, like, Janie Lane is one of the most underrated songwriters of the time period. But I throw, for me, myself, I throw Steve Lee in that mix as well. He's one of my favorites. Just great stuff all the way around throughout the whole catalog, not just on this album. But I will say, Die Hard here, though, is the last true 80s sounding album for Goddard. After this, they did end up going more towards a, I guess you would say, mainstream hard rock or mainstream rock at the time for 1996 and therefore. So kind of like maybe like a Bon Jovi, as but with Bon Jovi with balls. Bon Jovi that actually gives a shit and actually wants to play rock and roll. So that's the best way I can kind of describe like the transition here that Goddard did after this album. But this album, I don't know where you can find it. I don't know if you can find it on Spotify or Apple Music. I don't know. I don't have none of that stuff, but you can still buy it though, like physically in like this little package here. It's like a 5-disc of their first 5 albums. Just like a little compilation type deal. It has everything, like all the songs from each of the first 5 albums. So really good pickup too. I think I got like less than $20 when I found it. But let's just go to the track listings here, because like the whole album, you got 11 tracks. I will say probably like 2 of them do get left off the iPod for me. But the leadoff track, Higher, I just don't care for it, actually. And that's kind of strange to say with how great of an album this is. Like, the lead-off track isn't, like, one of the great... It's not a great lead-off track. But you got Mountain Mama coming in here. You got track number 4, She Goes Down. Really good heavy riff. As soon as this album comes on, any of these songs off the album come on like a random shuffle playlist or whatever, I know exactly what song and what band and what album this comes off of. And it's a very distinctive sound guitar tone to it, like I said. But track number five here, going to I'm Your Traveling Man, really good. Now, the next track, track number six, is the track that's worth buying, purchasing this album alone. Like, even if all the other songs weren't good on this album, I would have to buy this album just for this song here, track number six, Love for Money. Great riff, just great songwriting all the way around. I will actually say the solo isn't all that impressive or over the top or anything. Like, I was actually hoping back in the day to have a better solo, but it does enough. It's perfect. The song's still perfect. I don't want to change nothing because, like, as it stands right now, it's just great. So I don't know. When you start like finicking with that kind of stuff, like trying to make it a little bit more over the top as far as solos and stuff go, might actually hurt the song for your casual listener, but not for me, obviously. Like, I'll take whatever you throw me, crazy shit solo, and I'm all good for that. But you do have a cover here, Come Together, which is the Beatles, which I will say I'm not a big fan of the Beatles or just having covers in general. They do rock it. Goddard does do a good version and of their own style as well. Pretty heavy, pretty edgy. Track number nine, Dirty Devil Rock. Really good. Probably my second favorite track off of this album. Right from the start, you have Beavis
Hey, how's it going?
saying, oh, cool, yeah, haha, yeah, doing their thing. And, like, just for a couple seconds. And, like, I don't know if Mike Judge knew who Goddard was. I don't know. But that's just very interesting that, Beavis and Butthead are on this album. Like, it's just crazy because that is around the time when Beavis and Butthead first started coming out, started getting popular. So, but then you finish off here, track number 11, I'm On My Way, which is a great ballad, one of my favorite ballads from Goddard. Just awesome. I can listen to that anytime. But guys, this album here is so good. Like, if you like that sleazy, bluesy, not overly bluesy, I would say, like, it still has that real edge to it, sleaziness to it, but you do like some blues in your sleaziness, this is the album for you. Totally kick ass. And I will say it didn't do obviously nothing here in the US in 1994, but this band is from Switzerland. So it did go to number one on the Swiss charts and it did go platinum in Switzerland. So that's cool. That at least like their homeland knows how badass they are. So that's really cool to see as well. But yeah, the next album from 1996 is just called G. Not as good to me. I mean, but still good. It still doesn't come anywhere close to how great Dial Hard is, but it's still worth listening to. Like I said, I have all five of their first five albums from this compilation, but they actually have like over like 13 or 14 out studio albums now because they did end up having another singer once Steve Lee passed away. They did end up going on with another singer, and I don't know anything from that era, so I don't know. But man, Steve could write a song, and he wrote many, plenty of songs. So definitely a band for you guys to check out. But please start at Dial Hard from 1994. So coming in here with our second choice, guys, we have Zakk Wylde's "Pride and Glory."
This is Zakk Wylde.
The Zaz is all guy.
The man knows his way around five string.
Right, so this one here, I guess technically it is Zakk Wylde's first solo album, if you will. I don't know. I kind of just have it as a standalone, but I do see it in people's like Zakk Wylde chronological albums and stuff like that. So I don't know. I kind of have it as a standalone, but so just Pride and Glory, but it is Zakk Wylde's band. And he does the vocals and the guitars. So this is, like I said, 1994. You're coming off of Ozzy, No More Tears, Osmosis, that type of era of Ozzy. And it is different. I would say, like, because I do absolutely love Book of Shadows from Zakk Wylde, which he ended up doing after this, a couple years after this. And this is I like to explain to people, this is kind of like the bridge in between Zakk Wylde's like solo stuff, like as with Book of Shadows, to what he did with Ozzy, like the heavy stuff in Black Label Society. And like, I put this like in the middle between those two things, those two extremes, if you will. And it's a good mixture because you get some soul stuff in here, you do get heavy stuff, you even get like banjo stuff in here, but like you get a good amount of ballads, I guess you would say, at least a couple of them. But you do have 14 tracks here. Losing Your Mind is the lead off. It is that is a single. They did have a music video single as well. Horse Called War is a single as well, and I believe it was Troubled Wine was the other single. But this, like, I gotta say, Zakk Wylde, like, one of my favorite songwriters, another one that people overlook as a songwriter, I think. Like, I don't really hear too much. Like, everyone praises guitar solo or guitar work, and rightfully so. Great guitar work, great soloing as well throughout his whole catalog. But I think no one really talks about his songwriting as much. So I'm here to do that, talk about the songwriting. And obviously the great solos too. I mean, you can't have me talking about Zakk Wylde without talking about guitar solos. But this is, you know, like as far as like ballads go, or like the slower soulful stuff here. Oh my gosh, you got like Loving Woman, you got Sweet Jesus, very good. Found a Friend, really good solo in that as well. Oh my gosh, those three are great. And then even like a Cry Me a River is like more a little bit faster, but it still has that soulfulness to it. Like, Zakk has that soul voice. I know that's like the thing with Black Label. Like, I like Black Label. I have most of the Black Label stuff. But after like an album or two, I'm like, okay, this is kind of getting like, feels like kind of getting repetitive. Or I just get tired of it after like one album. It's just, okay, you know, but like, give me this. Give me Book of Shadows 1 or 2, you know, or anything like that. Anything that Zakk released kind of like in those veins of these albums, I can listen to that shit all day, you know, compared to Black Label and such. You have Troubled Wine, which is a heavy riff in there. You do have Machine Gun Man, pretty cool. Just, like I said, the choruses are real good. They're catchy as well. Everything just sounds really good on this album, especially for, like, say, a debut solo album too, which I will say it did do a little bit better than I thought it did. It did get to like 178 on the top 200 Billboard chart, which I didn't even know it even placed, because like no one ever seems to talk about this album. No one talks about Zakk's like first couple solo records, and I'm like, what is going on here? This is some of the best stuff of the 90s, and just in general, whether rock, metal, or just whatever was mainstream at the time, which wasn't that much good, which wasn't really any good stuff, to be honest with you, in mainstream.
Look like garbage.
But yeah, you finish off the album here too with Hate Your Guts, which is kind of like a tongue-in-cheek, funny song. You know, he's just talking about this guy's an asshole, and, you know, just shit like that. It's pretty funny. But, I think 14 tracks is a little too long, though. You could take off like one or two and have a way stronger of an album, but it's still strong nonetheless. It still makes, obviously, the first video here for 1994 for us, but I really enjoy, I think, like the soulful songs on here and the guitar solos and stuff like that on all of the songs just really bring this album up a notch. And Zakk's vocals just sound absolutely amazing. And it's just something that you wouldn't really, I guess, even at the time, like you wouldn't expect it from Zakk, especially with Book of Shadows, which will come out, in 96, a couple years after this. You would certainly, I guess, wouldn't expect that from just the casual fan, just from hearing Zakk Wylde from what you do know him from. But like I said, this is kind of like a perfect in-between, because if you heard this first, then go to Book of Shadows, that kind of makes sense. But if you just jump in the Book of Shadows after just listening to like Black Label Society or just Ozzy stuff, you're like, whoa, what is this? Like, you might not dig it, which would be crazy because it's absolutely amazing. But no, nonetheless, 1994 Pride and Glory, self-titled, is great. And this is the only album that they did as Pride and Glory. So it is what it is, but I mean, we still have it here to listen to, and it's absolutely amazing. Great guitar solos, great singing, great songwriting all the way around. Zach really shines, and he shines it on the next album too, and the Book of Shadows. But that's neither here nor there. We'll do a separate video for Book of Shadows. But yeah, for now, stick with Pride and Glory. All right, so for our last choice here in 1994, we had none other than the great band Cinderella with Still Climbing.
Hey, now you speak my language here.
Isn't there to say about this album other than it is great? So, first things first, it did reach number 178, too, actually, on the Billboard chart, 1994. But quickly fled the scene, if you will, because Cinderella, the name, the look, just the reputation at the time, people did not want 80s hair metal bands anywhere around them in 1994. So sad to say, it did not last very long on the charts, and not many people even knew about it. There wasn't even any promotion, hardly any at all. No music video or anything like that. It still is off Mercury Records, but this is kind of weird though too, because like I said, there's a decent amount to talk about on this album, because like obviously here you have a 4 year gap between Heartbreak Station and Still Climbing here, which this is for Cinderella's fourth album and final album. Sad to say as well, that heartbreaking to say, but yeah, it's very good. Now, a lot of people got turned off by Heartbreak Station. And I can understand that because it was so bluesy, had Western traces in there and such. It was just different. Out of the four Cinderella albums, that's the one that is, I guess you would say, the black sheep that doesn't really sound kind of like the others, if you will. It does, because like to me it does, because like that is who Cinderella is, like that is their influences and stuff. But yeah, as far as like a Cinderella album, most people do not gravitate to that one first. So, but no, you do have like, Tom Kiefer did have vocal cord problems and ended up having surgery on them, like around 92 or so. So that's what kind of held up on this album as well. He didn't know when he was writing songs for this album, he didn't know whether he could sing, let alone sing, or in a specific way, because he does have a couple different vocal deliveries that he does sing in now. And when he was writing lyrics, he just didn't know, hey, how am I going to sing this song? That's going to change the way the arrangement here. That's going to change, what I can say, what words, how, pronunciation, all that stuff. So, but nonetheless, you do have I guess, soundtrack song "Hot and Bothered" from Wayne's World, the first soundtrack or the first movie. Absolutely amazing song. One of my favorite Cinderella songs, I think, actually. And God, if that had a proper release in 1992, or even if this album was released in 1992, right after Heartbreak Station, I could definitely see it going gold, at least, even still in 1992, because like we talk about on the channel here, bands were still certifying gold in 1992, 1993. You had Lean Into It eventually certify in like 1992, 1993 from Mr. Big. Poison's Native Tongue went gold. Extreme, the second album, that ended up going like multiple times platinum, especially with the help of the ballads that came out a little bit later, like a year or two later since its release. It's just crazy to think about that. And then Tesla's Bust a Nut as well, 1994, that went gold. So the best way I could describe this album is not a sleazy Cinderella, but certainly an edgy Cinderella, and still has the blues feel to it, not like Heartbreak Station, more of a bluesy feel of the first two albums, you know, Night Songs and Long Cold Winter. Two great ballads on here. You know, one, Hard to Find the Words, basically talking about his mom. He wrote that for her after she passed away, so it is a very emotional song. And then you also have Through the Rain, which I think I might actually like better than Don't Know What You Got Till It's Gone. It's very Don't Know What You Got Till It's Gone style because of the piano in it, but I think I actually enjoy it. I leave, more times than not, I listen to Through the Rain more than Don't Know What You Got Till It's Gone. So, but you start off with Bad Attitude Shuffle, and you know, you had Tom Kiefer like saying fuck this, you know, like in like a radio, like it's very edgy. It's very different from what you expect from before, from Cinderella. Then you got here also too. I think Blood from a Stone might have been a single. I mean, from what it's worth back then, even if, because like there was, like I said, there was really no promotion for this album. But Blood from a Stone seems to be one that Cinderella does like to put on the greatest hits and such like that. Good song. But I will say Talk is Cheap, I think, and Easy Come, Easy Go, if I'm not mistaken. Those were actually, like, written, like, around the time of Night Songs, and just never made it to an album until, here, 1994. And, but both very good. And the title track here, Still Climbing, I gotta say, it is probably my favorite song off, well, one of my favorite songs off of this album. I just love the slide guitar. You know, the just amazing stuff. Just the riff too, because I'm guessing it's Tom on there doing the solo, because he does do most of the solos. But Tom, he does like this whirl, like, and then just jumps in the solo. Like, once he does that, everyone is like, all right, let's back the fuck up. Give him about 30 seconds here for this solo, and it's absolutely awesome. And the riff is still going right behind him, and it just sounds great. One of my favorite songs off this album, easily. Just like the lyrical content to it, too. The Road So Long is really good. Another good lyrical content. A little bit slower. This song technically finishes the album, because you do have Hot and Bother at number 11. But that, like I said, that's just kind of like a add-on bonus track that they just threw on here from the Wayne's World soundtrack. But I'm glad they did that, because I didn't want to have to buy just... I do have the Wayne's World soundtrack, but I didn't just want to buy that just for this song, you know, or just like, your random Cinderella fan shouldn't have to just buy a random soundtrack just for one song. But nonetheless, though, great, great. Free Willin' is just kick-ass, too. Like, that's just a kick-ass fast song. Just Cinderella just sounds, like, more pissed. Like I said, more edgier on this album. I don't know why someone wouldn't really care for this. Now, granted, I guess it is, it doesn't sound like 1994, but it is a little bit more on the darker tone of things, a little bit more serious. Like, I don't know. I think the songwriting's fine. I've seen people bitch about the songwriting on here. Like Tom has nothing to say in these songs. Like, when I seen one of those reviews like that, I'm like, are we listening to the same fucking album here, or what's going on? Like, I don't know. I think the songwriting's just fine. What you expect from Cinderella and Tom. But another crazy thing about this album, too, is Fred Curry isn't on this. And, you know, because he, at the time, was a part of Steven Pearce's Arcade, which we just recently talked about on the channel. And I will put the link to that right here above me. And now, it's just crazy to me that, you know, you do, because I believe it was Kenny Aronoff that did the drums on this. And he was from, you know, like John Mellencamp. You know, just like, not random, but like, just like different, you know, John Fogerty, you know, just like different bands, and you just wouldn't expect to be on a Cinderella album, especially when you got Fred Corey in the wings, or, you know, like, but I guess he was just busy doing his, you know, Arcade stuff and just doing other stuff and just didn't do that. So, and that's another thing too, like, that's really weird, like, Fred Corey is literally like only one Cinderella album, but meanwhile, he's like a part of the whole catalog, it seems like, you know, but I don't know, it's just like a weird mindfuck, if you will. You know, it's just like, wow, you know, I can't believe that. But nonetheless, guys, check out Still Climbing. Absolutely great album. If you're a fan of Cinderella and you still haven't checked this album out, I don't know what the hell you're doing. but I know people do talk shit on it, so that might have scared you off of it. But nonetheless, it's not my last ranked Cinderella album. I'll say that. And if you do want to see my Cinderella album ranking, check out this video right here. But let me know, guys, in the comments, what you guys think is still climbing. And then also let me know in the comments what you guys think of Zakk Wylde's Pride and Glory. And also just what you think of Zakk Wylde's solo stuff. Not Black Label. You could tell me that too, but like tell me more what you think about Zakk Wylde's like actual Zakk Wylde albums. And then finally, please, if you check out any of these albums, check out Goddard's Die Hard. Absolutely amazing. If you like that sleazy stuff, that just hard rock bluesiness, just really good, great vocals, great songwriting. Check them out. All three of these, you guys can't go wrong. But guys, thank you for watching the Crash Course Metal Show. Click the subscribe button, click the like button, comment, let me know what you guys think of these. And stay out of that collateral damage, guys. And if you guys enjoyed this video, click on another Forgotten Album series episode right here.